So, this is the first part of the video lectures on the idea of elasticity. And elasticity tries to go beyond the idea that demand slopes down and the idea that supply slopes up. Because there are lots of situations where knowing that if prices go up, people buy less isn't good enough to give us the answer we need. For many questions, we need a more exact relationship between price and quantity demanded, say for instance. And elasticity is how economists like to measure that. The key here, one of the key reasons why we care about this, is that often we're measuring the relationship or the responsiveness between one variable that we can control and another variable that we can't directly control. For instance, most firms have some control over the price that they charge, but they don't have direct control over the amount that customers want to buy from them. By lowering prices, they can influence the amount customers want to buy, and elasticity gives the strength of that relationship. The specific definition of elasticity is a little technical, as it says here. The elasticity of variable A, that's our outcome variable, with respect to B, that's the variable that's producing a change in A, measures the responsiveness of A to changes in B. The actual formula is down here. The elasticity of A with respect to B is the percentage change in A over the percentage change in B. And this is an all else equal kind of comparison. We're talking typically about movements along a fixed demand curve or a fixed supply curve. To refresh you, how do we normally calculate a percent change? Normally, when we calculate a percent change in some variable, we take the new value, x2, subtract off the old value, x1, then divide all that by the old value, x1, and then multiply all that by 100 so that we can convert a decimal into a percentage. So if we get 0.05 for all the work we do inside these square brackets, we multiply that by 100 to get to 5%. When doing these things, you want to remember your order of operations. So specifically, you do everything inside the parentheses first. That's what the P in PEMDAS is. And you work from the innermost parentheses toward the outer parentheses. Then if there are any exponents, you do those. Then if there's multiplication, you do that. Division, you do that. Addition, you do that. And finally, you do your subtraction. So, as an example of the normal way we calculate percentage changes, if the price of oranges goes from 90 cents to $1.20, our $1.20 is our new value. Our 90 cents is our original value, x1. So we plug in $1.20 here, 90 cents there, and 90 cents there. We get 30 cents inside this first set of parentheses. We have 90 cents on the bottom of that fraction. We divide through, and we get 0.333, or 1/3. And then we multiply that by 100, to know that it's 33%. As a second example here, let's suppose the price of oranges now goes from $1.20 to 90 cents. In that case, the old value, the original value, or starting value, is $1.20. So that's our x1. 90 cents is our new value, and that's our x2. So if we plug these in here, we're going to notice that although we get the same change of 30 cents, as in the last example, we're going to divide by $1.20 instead of 90 cents. So we get a different answer. We get a different answer for two reasons. One is the original example in the last slide was a price increase. So we had a positive percentage change. This example is a price decrease, so we have a negative percentage change. But even more so, what we want to notice here is that we have a different number here. We had 33% earlier, and now we have 25%. And that's because we have this different number here on the bottom. So the percentage change is different depending on which direction we have the price change in. And sometimes that's a little bit confusing and messy. So economists often like to use what's called the midpoint method for calculating a percentage change. And the idea of the midpoint method is that it uses the average value of x over the interval between x1 and x2 as the base value. So that's what's going on in this complicated fraction here. So specifically, whereas we just had x1 on the bottom of the fraction before, now all this stuff inside the curly braces is having us take the average of x1 and x2. So for a specific example here, if our price of oranges goes from 90 cents to $1.20, the top looks exactly like it did in our first example. But on the bottom, instead of just plugging in the 90 cents, we now plug in the $1.20 for x2, the 90 cents for x1, add them together to get $2.10, then divide by 2 to get $1.05, then we divide the 30 cents by the $1.05 and get 28.5%. So it's higher than the 25% that we got before and lower than the 33% we got before. So on average, we basically had a 28.5% change. The midpoint formula that you'll typically, the formula for calculating elasticity using this midpoint method that you'll typically see in most economics textbooks is pretty intimidating to most students. And it's pretty complicated. You have fractions within fractions. And I think when people use that, there's two big risks. At the sort of most basic level, there's a really big risk that with all those fractions within fractions, you're just going to make a mistake at some point, keeping track of what goes where. The other thing is, even if you do the operations correctly, with a really complicated formula like that, it's really hard for students to understand the meaning of the math that they're doing. So I would recommend that you break this down into three chunks. First, compute your change, your percentage change, in the B variable. So one of the variables is changing, B, and the change in B causes a change in A. So first, let's calculate how much the thing that originally changed changed. That's step one. Then we're going to calculate the change, the percentage change, and the outcome variable A. And now we sort of have an idea of how much did this change, how much did that change. And when we compare those two, that's what gives us our elasticity. And I think that if you calculate them separately in two separate steps, it's going to be much easier to really keep track of what's going on here. So, as an example of following this method, let's go ahead and say that our store raised prices from $3 a gallon to $4.50 a gallon. And when we did that, sales fell from 500 gallons to 420 gallons. So what was the elasticity of demand for milk? And notice if we go back to that earlier formulation of the elasticity, we know that quantity demanded is the thing that's the outcome variable that's being influenced by the input variable or control variable of price. So step one is let's think about how much our input variable, our control variable, changed. So price is our input variable, our B variable, and we're going to go ahead and make sure we know which one is which. Our original price, B1, is $3. Our new price, B2, is $4.50. So we take those and we plug those into a percentage change formula with the midpoint method. And on the top, we're going to get $4.50 minus $3. On the bottom, We're going to get 450 plus $3 all divided by 2. And we go through some calculations there. And we get $1.50 of increase on an average value of price of 375. And we get prices went up by 40%. How much did the amount we sold change? Here, the original value was 500 and the new value was 420. So we know that the amount we sold declined. And we'll be able to use that as a check to see whether or not we got the right answer. Because if something declined, we had better get a negative percentage change. Because a negative percentage change is a decline or a shrinkage. So we take these numbers and we plug them in. And notice on the top here, we get 420 minus 500 or negative 80. Because quantity shrunk by 80. On the bottom, we use that midpoint method. And we get the average value of 420 and 500 is 460. So I accidentally didn't say this before. We're moving the negative point out here, the negative sign out here. So got to keep track of where our negative sign is. We're going to divide 80 by 460. And eventually at the end of all this, we get our percentage change is that quantity demanded fell, had a negative percentage change of 17.4%. Last, we're going to combine our previous work to get the elasticity. So our percentage change in B was positive 40%. Our percentage change in A, quantity demanded, was negative 17.4%. We go ahead and plug those into the nice, simple elasticity formula, and we get negative 17.4% divided by 40% gets us negative 4.4435. And the idea of this is that when we increase prices by 1%, quantity demanded falls by 0.435%. Now, let me just go ahead and pause here to talk about an irrational historical convention. Among economists, there's a little bit of an attitude that everybody knows that the demand curve slopes down, and that when you raise prices, you're going to go ahead and have a decrease in quantity demanded. And so often economists talk about the elasticity of demand is 0.435, and they omit or just sort of suppress the negative sign. So often, elasticities are reported in absolute value terms. And, you know, among everybody who is really well versed in this, I suppose that makes a certain kind of sense. I guess it would be really tiring to be saying negative all the time. But for beginning students, that's really mystifying. I will always try to make sure I retain the negative sign here. But be aware that some textbooks or something like that may report things in absolute value terms. There are a couple of review questions here that you can go ahead and tackle on MyCR, and then we'll end this video segment.